This is a roundup of the 14th round of LV County Championship matches of the 2013 season, played between August the 2nd and August the 5th. And what an end to the season we have in prospect after Middlesex joined the front runners by beating third place Durham in a low scoring game at Lord's. This was a match dominated by the ball and two players on the edge of the England setup presently. Stephen Finn took 4 for 46 in Durham's first innings as they were dismissed for just 143 to put Middlesex, who really needed to win this match, on top. But Finn was outshone by Durham's Graham Onions, who took 7 for 62 to claim his fourth fifer of another excellent season. He was especially good on the second morning when he dragged his side right back into this contest by taking 5 for 20 in a spell of 5.2 overs. Admittedly, not all of his wickets came with unplayable deliveries, with a number of batsmen seemingly forgetting that this was four-day cricket rather than the T20 stuff they'd been used to of late. Thanks to Onions, Middlesex made just 168 for a lead of 25. But Finn then took his tally in the match to 7 wickets as Durham scored 171 second time out, which left Middlesex a slightly nervy 147 to get to win for the 5th time this summer. In the end, though, they made light work of that as they needed just 40 overs to reach their target for the loss of 4 wickets. So that was a defeat for the team who began this round in third, while Sussex, who started in second place, also lost as they handed Derbyshire their first win of the championship season. Only a 6-hour knock from Luke Wells, who made a patient 110, kept Sussex going on the first day, on which Sussex were all out for 314, a good recovery from a position of 189 for 6 at one point. Wells has come on leaps and bounds this summer. This knock was the one which glued his side's innings together. He was eventually the 7th man out after surviving for 253 balls. Derbyshire were reliant on their captain, Wayne Madsen, again in their reply. He made 97 out of his side's 274, which left them 40 runs behind, but at least kept them in touch after Derbyshire had been thrashed in their last two outings. Sussex, though, were just shading the game as the third day began, but by the end of it, they'd lost for the second time in succession. The main reason for that was the performance with the ball of Tim Groenewald, who was leading the attack in a team which contained 5 products of the county's academy. Groenewald took frequent wickets to claim analysis of 5 for 40, his second fifer of the summer, as an out-of-sorts Sussex, a side low on confidence right now, were all out for 133, which left Derbyshire 174 to win for the first time in the four-day game this season. It was Madsen who then guided his side home easily in the company of one of those academy products, Ben Slater. For the end of this innings, the Derbyshire skipper sat third on the list of run scorers in the championship. His side cruised home here by 9 wickets. Derbyshire's surprising success will make Somerset feel more nervous near the bottom of the table. They were thankful for the rain as they drew with Nottinghamshire in Taunton. They initially let their opponents off the hook on the second morning as Luke Fletcher scored his second 50 of the season out of his side's impressive 378 all out. Again, Somerset's top order failed as they collapsed to 81 for 6 before being dismissed on the final morning for 188, meaning that they had to follow on 190 runs behind. But Nick Compton made an unbeaten 70, and rain, which had ruined a large part of this match, then had the final say, with Somerset on 141 for 2 second time out. Back to the top, where leaders Yorkshire were also pleased with the weather gods as they drew with Warwickshire at Headingley Carnegie. With a number of their top order missing through call-ups to England and injury, Yorkshire were happy that Gary Balance maintained his excellent form of the summer on the first day. While few of his teammates could get going, he made 112 from 196 balls out of his side's 302 all out, a reasonable effort and one which at least earned them 3 batting bonus points, something which looked a little unlikely when they found themselves on 173 for 5 at one stage. Warwickshire looked as if they were going to concede a handy lead to the leaders until numbers 9 and 10, Keith Barker and Jeetan Patel, put on 99 for the 9th wicket, which actually helped their side into a lead, albeit a small one of 7 runs. Chris Wokes then produced his best performance of the summer with the ball, taking 5 for 42 as Yorkshire were all out for 180 in their second innings. Wokes produced some fine spells to keep his side ahead in this game as they went in search of their third successive win, having recently seen off both Middlesex and Nottinghamshire. Alas for them this time, the rain on the last day meant that they never got the chance to chase down the 174 runs they needed for victory. The draw actually saw Yorkshire increase their lead at the top of the table to 10 points with 5 games to go, but Middlesex made a real move on them with their win. With injured players about to return, they now have every chance of winning the title for the first time in 2 decades. Derbyshire now have a good chance of staying up, as they're just 14 points away from the safety line. There are some big games to come at both ends of the table. Lancashire should find themselves in the top flight again next year after they won for the 4th time in their last 5 games, this time thrashing Leicestershire by an innings and 52 runs at Grace Road. Their 380 in their first innings proved to be more than enough. There were 50s for Paul Horton, Simon Cattich, Luke Proctor and Lewis Rees, whose 85 was the best score of his fledgling championship career. Leicestershire slumped to 154 all out in reply before being dismissed following on the last day for 174, in which Carl Hogg took his tally of wickets this season to 42. He grabbed his second fifer of the summer, claiming 5 for 77 as the home side made life a little too easy for the skilled seamer, who is closing in on the best return in a season. He ensured that his side won this match comfortably, and they now have 1 foot back in the top division. All other second division matches were drawn, including the game featuring long-time leaders Northamptonshire, who played Gloucestershire at Wantage Road. This match was all about the batsmen on a very friendly pitch. Hamish Marshall was the first man to score 100, his 4th of the season, as Gloucestershire made 358 on the first day. But after Marshall completed his ton, eventually making 145, his side collapsed, losing their last 5 wickets for just 20 runs. The Northants openers then responded by opening up with a stand of 170, with Kyle Curtin making his second 100 of the campaign. He scored 122, but he was totally overshadowed by David Sales, who struck one of the innings of the season. In 15 previous attempts, the 35-year-old had not even managed a championship 50 this season, but how he made up for that. That was him getting to his 100, but he didn't stop there, going on to pass 150 for the 17th time in his long career, and then recording a double 100 for the 8th time. It had come off only 232 balls as well. Northamptonshire declared on 567 for 4, with Sales unbeaten on a memorable 279 ball, 255. That gave them a lead of 209, but it was still not enough for them to force a win, as Chris Dent and Michael Klinger put on 190 for the first wicket for their team. Dent reached 3 figures for the 2nd time this season and for the 4th time in his career. He ended on 128 out of his team's 227 for 1, with the only winner in this game being the lifeless pitch, one which the batsmen really enjoyed. The remaining 2 matches were rather dull affairs, with the rain being the dominant feature at New Road, where Worcestershire drew with Kent. Kent slipped to 25 for 4 on the first morning, only to be saved again by Darren Stevens and Ben Harmison, who put on 174 for the 5th wicket, with both men falling just short of their hundreds, but they did help their side make 324. Rain ruined much of the rest of the match. Moeen Ali went past 1,000 first-class runs for the summer, but the main story was an 8th wicket partnership of 126 between Tom Fell and Jack Chantrey, who came together with their side still needing 17 runs to avoid the follow-on. They did that easily, with Chantrey smacking James Treadwell over the top to record his maiden first-class 50, with Fell being left just 6 runs short of his first ever first-class ton in only his 5th game. Treadwell earned his best figures for 2 years by taking 5 for 51 as the game was washed out on the last day, with Worcestershire on 284 for 8, 40 runs behind. There was not a lot to write home about at the Aegeus Bowl either, where Hampshire drew with Glamorgan, 2 sides going nowhere this summer in championship cricket. Michael Carberry kept up his form on the first day, making 94 out of his side's 349. A total easily overtaken by the Welshman, who responded with 478 for 9 declared, in which Chris Cook struck his maiden first-class 50 as he made 92. There was a little wobble for Hampshire before night watchman Chris Wood struck 69 to go with Carberry's second inning 62 as Hampshire got to 237 for 4 for a lead of 108 when the rain sent everybody packing. By their own admission, Lancashire now need just a couple more wins from their last five games to guarantee an immediate return to the top tier. North Hants would have been happy with their 11 points this week, which keeps distance between them and the chasing pack. Essex were the biggest beneficiaries this week without even playing a game. If they win their match in hand, then they could yet make Northamptonshire nervous. The next round of games don't start until Tuesday, August the 20th, with the top three matches on this list beginning then. The middle three start on the following day, with the bottom two getting underway on the Thursday. Every point will be crucial, especially for those sides in Division 1, where nothing is yet anywhere near certain at either end of the table. Don't forget that you can see online highlights each day of all of these games at ecb.co.uk/LVCC, the place for news, scores and reports from all of the LV County Championship matches.